Hello! Welcome to Archival Adventures here on VTUL Studios' Twitch channel. I'm Anthony Wright de Hernandez, the Community Collections Archivist here at Virginia Tech. And on this show, we look at things from the archives. I do have a couple of acknowledgments to do just before we get started. And of course, you know, I'm totally prepared for that. So I want to acknowledge the Tutelo and Monacan people who are the traditional custodians of the land on which we work and live here at Virginia Tech, and recognize their continuing connection to the land, water, and air that Virginia Tech consumes. I want to pay respect to the Tutelo and Monacan nations and to their elders past, present, and emerging. I also want to acknowledge that Virginia Tech's Blacksburg campus was previously the site of the Smithfield Plantation, and at any point from 1774 to 1865, the Preston family enslaved 40 to 100 African men, women, and children on this land. I want to pay respect to those souls and acknowledge that Virginia Tech is undeniably tied to this legacy. Further, I want to acknowledge that Virginia Tech's Blacksburg campus was also previously the site of the Solitude Estate, which enslaved at least 30 African men, women, and children on this land, and acknowledge the contributions of the Fraction family and other enslaved persons in the creation and emergence of Virginia Tech as a major land-grant university. So, we did get a raid while I was doing the acknowledgments, so welcome Eric and the Whimsies from Eric's stream, I guess. Yeah, just the Whimsies. Welcome, Whimsies, to Archival Adventures. You would know me as Rogan27. I'm Anthony, the Community Collections Archivist here at Virginia Tech. This month on Archival Adventures, we've been looking at ornithological materials. So things having to do with the study of birds. And today is more bird stuff, less about the scientific study of birds and more about the actual sale of birds. So that is what we're doing today. I'm gonna say hello to people. So hi, Hannah. Hi, Key Squared. Hi, Allura, Rel, Melba, anybody else who came over with the raid, welcome in. Anybody who is watching on the VTUL Studios channel, welcome, welcome. So today's collection that we are looking at is the M.L. Foley collection, which of course I'm totally prepared and have this pulled up so that the description is in front of me and I can just tell you all about it. Narrator voice, he was totally not prepared. Give me 1 second, I'll pull up this guide and I can tell you what little there is in description of this collection. It looks like we received this collection, I don't know when we got it. We processed it and organized it in 2012. It includes receipts and more than 100 pieces of incoming and outgoing correspondence relating to M.L. Foley's business selling birds out of Salem, Virginia. Foley's letters concern the breeding, sale, and shipment of birds throughout the United States, as well as Central and South America. It also contains receipts for birds, freight, feed, licenses, and more. So not like the other collections that we looked at this month where it's the scientific study of birds. Instead, this has to do with the commercial sale and breeding of birds. And some of the letters in here are pretty interesting, but of course I also still have the same bird-related rare books that we've had all month. So if we decide we want to see some lovely photos of birds, I have those. Also, I'm wearing bird-related pins today. You may not know these pins, but it's a cockatiel as a bowling pin and a socketeel. If anybody had ever seen Alex the Honking Bird on any social media, those pins are from that. So I'm going to switch us over to the documents, and we will take a look at what there is. Wraith, thank you. Scattered thoughts. Let me switch to the document view. We can start taking a look at these things. So ML Foley, letters and other things. Kira has dropped the finding aid into the chats. So if you want to take a look at it, that could give you a little bit of additional information. There's not a lot of like lists of various things because it's really just correspondence and receipts. But if you have like a particular date range you'd like me to look through, I can do that. Before coming to stream today, my brain was fully into next month's topics, looking at things that I'm going to be featuring for the history of barbecuing and grilling and whatnot, which is what we're doing in July. Anyway, so this folder, this first folder, is correspondence from 1959. So one thing that you find in a lot of people's papers in archives is letters and correspondence. And so, you know, you get to hang out with me today while I read dead people's mail, which can be a lot of fun. This is relatively recent mail, stemming from like the late 1950s. So this one is on Art Dura Cleaner's letterhead. And Art Dura Cleaner's was located, it looks like, is located in Smithfield, North Carolina. And the owner is listed as A.C. Gentry, which may not be a familiar name to everyone, but if you grew up on the East Coast, you likely saw A.C. Gentry mentioned in local commercials. I know it's a name that I recognize having grown up in the D.C. area. So this first letter actually struck me as somewhat surprising because I saw it's a letter from A.C. Gentry to M.L. Foley. And even though I have basically no knowledge of who A.C. Gentry is, I knew the name from local commercials growing up. So this letter is from December 31st, 1959. And it is about wanting prices on birds. And it's, "Dear sir, what do you get for blackneck pheasants? I want 6 hens, 1 cock, if the price is right. What about Erbil's Francolins? What ages are these birds? Give best price, underlined. Let me hear from you soon. Yours truly, A.C. Gentry." It's not like the eloquent letter that you would get in like the 1800s. This is more of like a brief like memo, and it's asking about the price for blackneck pheasant, and apparently A.C. Gentry wanted 6 hens and 1 cock if the price was right, and then asked about Arabelle's Francolins, which I'm not familiar with that particular bird species. Let me see. Rebels Francolins? Black Francolin? Huh. I have... So this very much looks like Arabelles or Arakels. There's a bird called a Black Francolin that is another kind of pheasant. So I'm guessing that's probably what he's referring to there. But like, just the really short, not even fully punctuated sentences in this letter. What about these Francolins? What ages are these bird? Give best price. Like, okay. Generally, when you talk to a shop that specializes in something like the sale of birds, I would think that they would be giving you the best price or their price up front. This "give best price" underlined just seems rather aggressive to me. But anyway, I love this letter in particular just because It's from AC Gentry, who's a well-known name on the East Coast. It's on letterhead from a cleaning service, like a furniture cleaner. And then just the tone of the letter itself, just really kind of an interesting piece to me. This one I used for the graphic on the tweet today. It's a typewritten letter, and I'll put the AC Gentry behind it for a second. You can see the difference in the coloration of the paper. Because a lot of the letters in here, a lot of the ones that are signed ML Foley, which I'm guessing are copies that he kept for his records, are on this very, very yellowed paper. It's like basically the same color as the table that I'm using, which just, it's on really acidic paper and has yellowed significantly over time. So this is September 22nd, 1959, a letter to M.S. Barty in Huntsville, Alabama, from M.L. Foley. The golden pheasants you inquired about were hatched during the first 2 weeks in May. These birds are in excellent condition and in fine plumage. It's spelled plumage, it's plumage, of course. None of the birds have crooked toes or split or broken beaks from debeaking. We are offering them at this time for $7 per pair. Also have a few birds hatched a little later. Our ringnecks were hatched from the last week in April to the last week in May. These are fat and healthy birds, but due to feather picking at the present time, they don't have but a few tail feathers. It would take about 3 weeks for them to grow out. These birds are $2.50 each now and will be $2.75 the 1st of November. We appreciate your inquiry very much and would give your order our most prompt attention. So, a much nicer tone, different author, obviously, and this is his business, selling these birds, but a very pleasant letter. Golden pheasants, if you're curious what they look like, you can always pull up an image on the wonderful Google. I can try and get one. Open the picture. I just want to maximize the picture, please. Aha, that's what I want. So a golden pheasant, which is the first bird being discussed here, is So that is a golden pheasant. Very pretty bird. And in the letter it mentions none of them have crooked toes or split or broken beaks from debeaking. So debeaking would be not an intentional process that the breeder or salesman would do. It would be a thing caused partly by stress and infighting of the birds in captivity. So that would be a common thing that somebody who was shopping for birds would be wanting to not find, where a bird's basically had part of their beak bitten off by another bird. And so he's claiming that none of them have that. Switch back to the document. Oh, really? Was not worth it. Debeaking could be done to keep them from breaking eggs as well. So my only experience was with, so my only personal experience and my knowledge of it is from pet birds in the parrot family. And with pet birds, and particularly parrots, it's usually a result of them fighting in the pet store. But that's really interesting. I would not have considered that. And so the second part here, the second bird that's mentioned is the ringneck pheasant. Which I can throw up on the screen as well. So there is a ringneck pheasant for you. Not quite as colorful, but still a striking species. Apparently these were, the ones for sale were hatched the last week in April through the last week in May, fat and healthy, but due to feather picking, they don't have but a few tail feathers. And so it would take more time for them feathers to grow out. The golden pheasants were much more expensive, $7 per pair. Whereas these were $2.50 each. So for a pair, these were about $2 cheaper than the golden pheasants. And so my assumption with feather picking is the same thing. Fighting amongst the birds in captivity, or birds picking out their own feathers due to stress. But if anybody else has other information, comments from your grandfather. I mean, that seems like as good a source as I have at the moment. My knowledge of debeaking and feather picking, like I said, is entirely from my my knowledge and experience from pet birds, particularly cockatiels and parakeets and lovebirds. So the next letter that we have in here is dated September 10th. I think it's September 10th, 1959. It appears to be from Wesley Cottrell in Grand Haven, Michigan. Dear sir, please send me your price list on the following. One pair Elliot's, one pair Cheers, one trio Reeves, one pair or two Urkel's Franklins, and one trio silver, and one trio silvers and one adult hens. Yours truly, W.J. Cottrell. So, again, I think these are mostly pheasants being spoken about. Whoops. I'm typing the wrong search terms. Yep. So again, all of these being discussed here are pheasants. Let's see. Here we have just a small little postcard. September 11th, 1959, postmarked in Chile, Wisconsin. Dear Mr. Foley, would you please send me a price list on your Mutants, Elliots, Cheers, and that same one, the Urkels or Crockles or something, Franklins. Would like to locate a pair of each breed mentioned, especially the Elliots. Thank you sincerely, Good, thank you. Sincerely yours. Good luck. Arthur G. Paul, RRI, Chile, Wisconsin. Particularly interested in the Elliott's pheasants, this one. I'm not an expert on pheasants, but apparently, apparently they did some business in pheasants in 1959. Dear sir, please send me a price on one pair of Elliott's Cheers and Erkels. This handwriting is much easier to read. I'm going to find out what this bird is. E-R. E-R. C-K-E-L apostrophe S. Erkels Franklin. I have located an entry in the Wikipedia. Erkel's spurfowl, also known as Erkel's Franklin, is a species of game bird in the family Phasianidae, described in 1935 by German naturalist Edward Ruppel from specimens collected in the mountains of Ethiopia, coined the binomial name Perdix Erkeli. The specific epithet was chosen by Ruppel in honor of assistant Theodor Erkel, who had helped with the collection of the specimens. It is the largest African spurfowl. Huh. I have a picture here that I can show if I can get it to load in my browser, and we'll all know what this bird is now that we've seen it mentioned many, many, many times in these letters in just these first few minutes. Yes, Erkel's Franklin was not worth it. So that is what one looks like. It was difficult for me to make out the handwriting on some of these and actually figure out what they were spelling. That's kind of what I thought it was, but then I must have typed it incorrectly or something the first time I tried to look it up, because I didn't find it right away. We have a few more from ML Foley, heading outbound, October 14th, 1959. Mr. Jack Pfeiffer, dear sir, thank you very much for your inquiry on ornamental pheasants. The birds you inquired about were hatched the last week of April. They are in excellent condition and in fine plumage. I am sorry that I do not have available a pair of silver breeders, although a one-year-old pair will breed if attended and fed properly. We are offering the silvers at $10 per pair and an Amherst cock at $6. The shipping charges from here should be about $5. We would appreciate your order and give it our most prompt attention. This makes me really wonder about how birds were shipped in 1959. I'm not going to dig into that on stream because my focus is the documents that we have and things like that, but I'm very curious now about shipping for birds. U.S. Postal Service. So I know from prior professional experience that shipping horses from Montana to Hawaii in roundabout 2011 would be done via FedEx most cheaply, and FedEx had the most experience for what was technically international shipping of horses. I'm not going to go into all of the reasons why I know that, but I used to work in the relocation industry and helping move people from place to place, and so I know a little bit about shipping horses, but I had never. Like, I'm curious about, like, the actual conditions for shipping birds via post. I mean, you're probably right, it would have been U.S. Postal Service, but just the idea of taking a live creature and putting them into some sort of shipping vessel and sending them just feels weird to me. Here we have a letter to Mr. Ernest Thurston in Ivy, Virginia, October 14, 1959. Dear sir, the following is a list of the Cochin Bantams that my friend has for sale. One pair mottled, four pair buff Columbia, three pair Searchin, one pair and five hens black, and one trio white. These birds were hatched this year. The price is $4 per pair and $5 for the trio of whites. Please tell me the man that wanted the Reeves cock that I can let him have a young one for $7. Ask Mr. Thorne if she wants a young golden hen for $3. He inquired about one, but I have forgotten his answer. I am planning on bringing the other birds to you and Mr. Thorne on Wednesday, October 21st. If either of you should want any of these other birds, please let me know as quickly as you can, and I will bring them with the others. Let me bring that trio of cheers also, $20. So mention of bantams, bantam generally in bird parlance, yeah, it's just a small breed of chicken. That's what I thought. Just have to double check because not an expert on all kinds of birds, but I had thought it was just a different kind of chicken. And yeah, bantams are just small chickens, so. Here we have some letterhead from the Division of Wildlife, Department of Natural Resources, Waterloo Wildlife Experiment Station, New Marshfield, Ohio, to Mr. Millard L. Foley. So apparently the M in M.L. Foley stands for Millard, which I did not know from the finding aid. Dear Mr. Foley, I received your most welcome letter and was pleased to hear that you have an Elliot cock for sale. Please hold the bird for us. You neglected to quote a price in your letter of December 23rd. If you still wish to sell the cock, send me the price and I will process a requisition. Sincerely yours, Arthur C. Sickles, Operations Supervisor. Not Mallard. No, not Mallard Foley. Millard Foley. let's see what else we have. So here's one from Lebanon, Connecticut. Dear sir, I am interested in buying one or two Elliot hen pheasants, also pair or trio of cheers. Please let me know what you are asking for them. Interesting. The paper that gets used for sending letters is somewhat interesting. We do have all of the envelopes too, which have stamps on them. I could show those briefly too. Maillard, key squared. Yes, Maillard would be tasty. That is true. Dear Mr. Foley, I read your ad in the Gazette. I would like to obtain one pair of silvers, preferably a proven pair of something, and also am in the need of an Amherst cock. I'm going to guess that this is a proven pair of bantams, but with the way this handwriting is, it's very hard to be certain that that is actually the word there. Would you please send me your prices on these listed above, if available, and approximate shipping charges from Salem, Virginia to states Statesville, North Carolina. Thank you, yours truly, Jack Pfeiffer. Hi, Fluiden. How are you? So I don't have a date on this one on the letter. It was postmarked October 12th, 1959. And yeah, this Jack Pfeiffer's handwriting here, it's actually very nice. It's very elegant, looks very pretty, very hard to read, as is so often the case. So many handwritten letters are just up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, and you can't tell if it's an M, an R, an N. And like in the case of this word that I believe is Bantams, I know there's a letter that goes up. I know there's another letter that goes up and has a loop. It is pretty obvious that there is an S on the end. Otherwise, most of those letters just look like bumps, multiple bumps in a row. But from context, I'm guessing that's wanting a proven pair of bantams, which would mean a pair of the bantam chickens that has been proven to successfully breed together. So this is a reply to this letter. So this letter from Henry Safranik in Lebanon, Connecticut. Here we have a reply. 2 days later, October 19th, 1959. Dear sir, thank you very much for your inquiry on ornamental pheasants. I am very sorry that I do not have any more Elliots. I sold the last pair only yesterday. I have one trio of Cheers breeders left. The two hens laid 43 eggs this season, but I will tell you that the Cheer cock is afraid of these two hens and will breed only occasionally. Another cock will have to be placed with these hens. I am offering them at $20 for the two hens and with or without the cock. We would appreciate your order and give it our most prompt attention. So that seems to be just the standard closing for his letters. We would appreciate your order and give it our most prompt attention. But he's willing to sell the two hens and the one cock, or just the two hens. Either way, $20, because the cock is apparently afraid of the two hens and will only breed with them occasionally. Oh, and we've got a series going on, because we have another letter from Henry Safranik. I'm just double checking. Yes, indeed, from Henry Safranik in Lebanon, Connecticut. A few days later, October 23rd, 1959. Dear sir, thank you for your reply to my letter, and I am sorry that you have no Elliot. Hen left. I only bought my pair last spring and lost my hen from eating rat nip. We have been troubled with pack rats this summer, and one must have carried a piece of bread into their pen as I lost her the next day. I don't know much about rare pheasants, as this is my first year with them, and although your offer on the Cheers is okay, I don't know where I could get another cockbird from. So think my best bet is trying to buy a young pair to start with. My Elliot hen laid about 20 eggs, half of which were deformed and which I did not set out. Out of the 10 which I did set, 5 were good, but I lost them after they hatched. I had them with 6 bantam chicks under a bantam hen. I guess that they were much too flighty for her, and she killed them on me the second day. I used to raise 400 to 500 ringneck under bantams each year, but no longer have time to take care of that many birds. So as a pastime, I thought I would try a few pairs of rare pheasants. The only person that I have met that raises rare pheasants around here is Mr. Steve Ribello of Somerset, Massachusetts, who has some of the most beautiful pheasants I have ever seen. I bought a young pair of Lady Amhersts from him and raised 8 young ones. I was both surprised and happy that they bred the first year. I see by your ad in the Gazette that you also have Urkel's Franklins. What are you asking for a young pair, as I would like to try raising some? I would also appreciate it if you could send me the name of any reliable place here on the East Coast where I could buy an Elliott hen, as the express charges are so high when you have birds shipped from out west. Lord Portico, the drama of these three letters, it's just a simple sales inquiry, and then it comes into this entire discourse on just rat poison, and I've tried so many different kinds of birds, and bantam murder. Yes, the bantam hen killing the chicks that were the pheasant chicks, and just reading old people's mail, or reading dead people's mail, is really interesting. Not why I became an archivist, but really interesting. M.L. Foley. So this is from P. Mullaney, October 29th, 1959, Keyport, New Jersey. Dear sir, would you send me a price list of fancy pheasants, 1958, hatched or older? Thank you, Patrick Mullaney. P.S. Do you have peafowl or bantams? Oh, whoa! There's a fourth letter. So the last letter from Henry in Connecticut was October 23rd. And we have a reply from M.L. Foley, October 31st. Dear Sir, Ralph Meacham of Rockingham, North Carolina, or Walter Oakey of Winston-Salem, North Carolina, will probably have an Elliott hen for sale. I visited them a short time ago, and they had some at that time. I would say that the express charges would be about $7. I have one pair of proven breeders in Urkel's, and one pair of this year's hatch left. I'm offering the breeders at $25 and the young at $10. You should be able to get a cheercock from Meacham or Oakey or Ribello for about $8. If you should like to have any of these birds, I would be glad to ship them upon reply from you. And we have another letter in this series. That was four. I have a fifth. Dated November 7th, 1959. Dear Sir, thank you for the nice letter you sent me and the information I asked for about the Elliott hen. Enclosed, you will find a check for $10, for which I want you to send me a pair of the young Urkels you wrote about in your letter. So kindly send by express to my nearest station, which is Henry Sophronic, Willimantic, Connecticut. I thank you again. Yours, Henry Sophronic, Kick Hill Road, Lebanon, Connecticut. So, we probably won't learn any more about the saga of searching for the Elliott hen, because I would guess that Henry went to one of the other sellers that he was referred to, but he did come back and spend $10 to buy a pair of Elliott hens, to buy a pair of young Urkels. Such a good resolution, like a whole five letter series with chicken murder and everything. Here's one from November 12th. Dated November 12th, postmarked November 16th, 1959. From someone's date book, a play in five posts, yes. Dear sir, please send me a price list of your pheasants. Thanks, Dewey Sanders, Liberty, South Carolina. Like, envelope, one single page from a date book, or an appointment book. So, I would have never been able to send a letter like this growing up. I would have thought, no, I can't use a small scrap of paper like this. I need an actual, like, writing pad or a full sheet of paper or something. But having worked here, people wrote on whatever was available. Truly. Truly strange measurements of paper have I seen here. One that is just a postcard again, November 9th, 1959. Dear sir, please send me your price list, and if I can pick up birds on Sunday. So someone in Culpeper, Virginia, C.E. Hoffman in Culpeper, Virginia, asking for a price list and if birds can be picked up on Sunday. Unclear whether that request was this coming Sunday or just Sunday in general. Culpeper being probably close enough that he may have been inquiring about that coming Sunday. Ooh, this one is a postcard. The picture on the front is Swartz's Motel on State Route Number 2. Half a mile east of city, Stuart Warner Safe Air Heat, Beauty Rest Beds, Tile Baths, Telephone Taylor 0792, Toledo, Ohio. AAA approved. So the front of it is an actual postcard of a roadside motel, which were totally a thing. There are people who literally collect postcards of roadside motels because this was one of the main advertising methods for roadside motels. And so while not a photograph, this is art. This is a drawing of Swartz's Motel in Toledo 5, Ohio. The part about birds on it, Dear sir, please quote me prices on pheasants and what kind and how old. Yours truly, Grant Swartz. Based on that, I'm going to guess this person probably has some affiliation with the motel itself, considering that the inquiry is from someone named Swartz, and the postcard is Swartz's Motel. Ooh, we finally actually have a price list supplied. November 10th, 1959. Dear sir, thank you very much for your inquiry on ornamental pheasants. The following list of birds were all very early hatched. All were hatched during the last week in April and early May. I also have some true silvers that were hatched in the first week of April. With proper care and feeding this winter, all of them should breed well this spring. All birds are in fine plumage and have no crooked toes. Mutants for $7 per pair, silvers at 10, Reeves at 12, Reeves proven breeders at 15, black neck at 7, golden at 7, cheer at 10, each breeder hens, Urkels proven breeders at 25, one pair only. We would appreciate your order and give it our most prompt attention. We would be glad for you to come any Sunday. Just drop me a card a day or so in advance. So that I believe, is in response. Yeah, that's in response to that note. So apparently Sundays are okay with advance notice. So if anybody travels back to 1959 and is in search of a bird to save the world, which is why you were time traveling in the first place, you can go and see M.L. Foley in Salem, Virginia to get pheasants on Sunday, as long as you send a card in advance to let him know you're coming. November 13, 1959. I don't know why I went to time travel, but, you know, archives would be great research spots to research time travel trips. So this is in response to the motel postcard. Dear sir, thank you very much for your inquiry on ornamental pheasants. The following list of birds were all very early hatched. Most of them were hatched in May. I have some silvers that were hatched in April. With proper care and feeding this winter, all of them should breed well this spring. All birds are in good condition and good health and fine plumage and have no crooked toes. Basically the same response. Mutants at 7, silvers at 10, Reeves at 12, Reeves proven breeders at 15, Blacknecks at 7, Golden at 7, Cheer at 10, each breeder hens, Urkels, proven breeders 1958. One pair of them for $25, and ringnecks at $250 each. So slightly altered, almost identical phrasing to the other letter that we just looked at, but with details altered to address the questions that were posed by that client. Let's see, what else do we have? This one's an interesting letterhead. From the House of Birds, West Jordan, Utah. November 18th, 1959. Dear Sir, wow. Slightly difficult to read, this one. Something your price on Elliot's, if you will, please. Needs some for next spring. I can't read this first word. But the House of Birds in West Jordan, Utah was in need of Elliot's for the following spring. Let's see. Just gonna be looking at a couple of these. See if I have any more like letter and response. Ooh, Tiverton, Rhode Island. Oh. Oh! Oh! Ha! yeah. Kindly? That possibly. Oh, no, it's not kindly. It's, so these first two words run together, which is why I couldn't get it. It's like your like you're paid on Elliot's. I think it says paid. No, it's price, but like your price on Elliot's, if you will, please. Need some for next spring. Very abrupt and to the point. The kind of thing you would send in like a text message or an online help request or something like that. Not what you expect from letters in the 1950s. Or not what we're trained to. But guess what I just found? Guess what I just found? It's a letter. And can you guess who? Yes, yes, the sixth letter. It's letter number six. I'm going back to grab the other ones because we have a sixth letter. The fifth letter was November 7th. This letter is November 19th from the same person, Mr. M.L. Foley. Dear sir, I received my birds Tuesday afternoon and they arrived in very good shape. They were okay, but today, Friday, when I came home from work, I found the hen dead. We have had a week of very cold weather. It hasn't been above 32 degrees since they came, and it has been down to 14 degrees. I will now have to locate another hen. For anyone watching who is in not the U.S. and uses other units of measurement for temperature, 32 degrees would be 0 Celsius, and 14 would be minus 10 degrees Celsius. I will now have to locate another hen. Do you leave your Franklins out all winter? I have a small coop in their pen, which they have been using, and they have plenty of cover. They are a rather pretty bird, and I sure hope to be able to raise them. Would you know where I might buy another hen? I see that you have de-beaked them. Do they have a tendency to be cannibalistic? I really don't have any idea as to how to produce higher fertility in pheasants, as never was faced with that problem when raising ringnecks. I always keep extra cocks in the spring and used those that were most aggressive and showed the most development. Also having the breeding pens together where the cocks could see each other seemed to help by making them jealous, I would say. I have only one pair each of pheasants, so I am afraid that I will have to just rely on luck and will try your feeding program on them for now. I believe that too much interbreeding has been one of the reasons that rare pheasants have this drawback. I sent to Paul R. Hartzog of Niles, Michigan for my Elliott hen and also bought a pair of black or dark-throated goldens from him. They are the best birds that I have bought so far. My first Elliots came from North Carolina, and although they were feathered beautifully, they had crooked toes, and that has been enough to stop me from buying any more from him. When you pay $35 to $40 a pair for birds plus express, I think that you should get the best, or at least should be told beforehand about such things. I also bought a pair of young blue Manchurians from him that are extremely nice and hope to raise some this coming spring. I would appreciate any information that you found helpful in raising your Elliots, as my chicks were so active that is what must have prompted the hen to kill them, as I wrote you in my last letter. I always used eggs and hard-pressed cottage cheese on my young pheasants, besides keeping good pheasant starter in front of them. Also, in regards to higher fertility in pheasants, I read where one breeder put his cocks under lights for about 4 to 6 weeks before putting them in with his hens. This proved to be very helpful in making the first eggs more fertile. This was with game pheasants, and don't know how it would work with ornamentals. If you have extra birds that you could try it with, it might prove to be beneficial. As I have only started last spring with rare pheasants, we'll have to rely on trial and error system for now. I sure appreciate any information anyone gives me that they find helpful and might be helpful to me. So, more dead birds. This guy's not having a good time of trying to get started raising ornamental pheasants. And apparently they were de-beaked. I am curious as to why such a thing was done. I'm going to see if a quick search will bring me an answer. Cannibalism. Birds may begin pecking each other, which can lead to death. Begin watching for pecking and signs of cannibalism right away. To prevent cannibalism, provide adequate space, adequate numbers of feeders and waterers, reduce the amount of light, avoid sudden changes in environmental conditions, and remove sick or weak birds right away. You may also try using peepers, which are blinders for pheasants. If all else fails, you can de-beak your birds. This is from a site called Purely Poultry, giving information on game bird and ornamental pheasant care. Apparently, pheasants will attack each other and peck each other, and so that would be why there's talk in these letters of de-beaking them, which really seems a very cruel practice, because that's a permanent alteration to the bird. So if you've ever heard of like pet bird owners clipping their bird's wings, that is absolutely a thing that is done, and it is done for the safety of the bird, because indoors, if they've got the full length of their wings and can get up to full speed, they can slam into the wall and kill themselves. So you clip off the tips of the wings so they can't reach those speeds. But you have to do it periodically because those feathers grow back. Whereas if you de-beak a bird, that beak is not going to grow back. Let's see, who else do we have here? Did we look at the Dewey Sanders one? I thought we had. Maybe we didn't. I thought this was another reply, but I cannot find the original. So, not going to spend too much time, going to find more interesting things. Actually, we are an hour in, and we've just been reading things about 1959. There's a lot more. Let's see what happens if we jump forward a year. Ooh, Hannah has some information. According to a website I found, de-beaking, also called beak trimming, is the act of cutting the lower and upper points of the beaks. The trimmed upper beak is usually shorter than the lower beak. De-beaking birds will help prevent feed wastage, cannibalism, feather picking, and egg eating. Birds that are normally de-beaked are laying hens, turkeys, quail, and ducks. Awesome. Thank you for that, Hannah. Because my only experience, like I said before, my primary experience is with pet parrots. And in pet parrots, one of the things that happens, especially if you put lovebirds and, say, cockatiels together, is that they will fight and the lovebirds will... the result is likely that the cockatiel's beak will end up getting sheared off in the fighting. And similar to how it's described there, but it's a result of the actual like fighting of the birds, not something that's done for a particular purpose. Ooh, we have a reply. January 3rd, 1962, Mr. A.C. Gentry, which, if you'll recall, is who penned the initial letter that we looked at from 1959, So this is a reply to the first letter we looked at, the one that was originally written on December 31st, 1959, from Art Dura Cleaners, penned by A.C. Gentry, where he was asking for black necks and wanted 6 hens and 1 cock, if the price is right, wanted to know about Urkel's Franklins, what ages are they, said, give best price, underlined, let me hear from you soon, Mr. A.C. Gentry. So the response, if nothing else, my streams make you go look up information and learn things. Hey, it is marked as educational. So whether that is you're learning things directly from me or looking them up for yourself as I spark curiosity, that's all good. Dear sir, thank you very much for your inquiry on ornamental pheasants. I have only a few birds left for sale. My sales were beyond my expectations and wish that I could have doubled the number that I raised. The blacknecks were hatched in May and should make very good breeders this season. I have 2 cocks that are unrelated to the hens and 6 hens. If you wish to purchase these birds, I would like to know at once, for I was intending to put them in the deep freeze next week. I also have a very limited number of the following birds. They are all in excellent health and fine plumage. Blacknecks, $2.50 each. Mutants, $2.50 each. Goldens, $2.50 each. Silvers, $10 per pair. Reeves, $12 per trio. We would appreciate your order and give it our most prompt attention. Respectfully, M.L. Foley. Yes, educational. Mission accomplished. So here's one from Russell Powell in Carbondale, Pennsylvania. Dear sir, will you please send me the prices of the birds which you have for sale in the Gazette? I do not know which Gazette, but that's the second person, one from Connecticut and one from Pennsylvania, to refer to the Gazette just by calling it the Gazette. A letter from January 4th from Fishersville, Virginia. Dear sirs, I would like to inquire as to whether or not you have at this time pheasants to sell. I have some 12 to 20 ringneck pheasants, which I started by ordering the eggs from somewhere in Pennsylvania, but I would like to add to this flock, perhaps with a different breed. Do you sell eggs or live birds? May I hear from you at your earliest convenience as to price, delivery, etc. Thank you. Yours very truly yours, J.E. Wheeler, Jr. Oh, we have another letter from A.C. Gentry. So this is the third letter in this series. Dear sir, please ship me 6 hens and 1 cock of your blackneck pheasants at $2.50 each, which will be $17.50, enclosed is check. Are they any harder to raise than the ringneck pheasant? Thanks, yours truly, A.C. Gentry. We have a response to the one that I just read from Russell Powell. That would be this one. We have a response. Also, just for anyone who's not familiar, since it's come back up, I just want a quick overview. Huh. So AC Gentry is what I'm trying to find. There is a company called AC Gentry, which is an architectural sheet metal company. Curious. There's not a lot of history on the company. I'm really curious now. Like that. Because that is a name I was familiar with. And it's the owner of this furniture cleaner. Furniture cleaning company in 1960. There's also an artist born in 1927 named A.C. Gentry. So this may not, this person may not be related in any way to the A.C. Gentry that I am familiar with from my youth. Interesting. Very curious that that name is apparently rather common. Anyway, we have a response to this letter. So, was asking for the price list. Thank you very much for your inquiry on ornamental pheasants. I have only a few birds left for sale. My sales this year were beyond my expectations and wish I could have gained. So it's basically a form letter at this point. If the blacknecks and mutants are not sold by January 16th, I am going to put them in the deep freeze. So these being pheasants, put them in the deep freeze. I would assume he's going to kill them and freeze them and sell the meat to a butcher, because pheasants are game birds and therefore are birds that people eat. We do have a response to Mr. Wheeler in Fishersville. That was this one with the black and red ink on the typewriting. Dear sir, thank you very much for your inquiry on ornamental pheasants. I have only a few birds left for sale. My sales this year were beyond my expectations and wish I could have raised double the number. I can furnish all of the birds in unrelated pairs. The Reeves are early 59 hatch and also some proven breeders at the same price. If the blacknecks and mutants are not sold by January 16th, I am going to put them in the deep freeze. All birds are in fine plumage and excellent health. Any of the following birds are as easy to raise as ringnecks, so therefore you shouldn't have any additional trouble raising them. Of course, each breed has to be bred in separate pens. I have had a little experience and perhaps could answer some of your questions, some of the questions that you may have. As to the delivery, perhaps we could meet about halfway between Roanoke and your home. Blacknecks and mutants are just another color of ringneck, in my opinion, and suggest that you try some of the other breeds. Blacknecks are $2.50, mutants $2.50, goldens $2.50, silvers $10 a pair, Reeves $12 a trio. We would appreciate your order and give it our most prompt attention. So it's... I wonder, these are all signed M.L. Foley, but I wonder if he actually wrote out all of the responses himself, or if these were prepared by, like, a secretary or somebody else in the business. Having sent letters in response to inquiries before, I definitely see what I used to do, which is, like, oh, I've answered an inquiry like this before. Let me go find the letter I sent for that and basically copy it and just change out the couple of details that need to be changed. And that seems to be what's happening here, which may also be part of why he kept copies of every letter. A lot of times when you get somebody's personal correspondence added to a collection, you're just getting the letters that they received from other people. You don't have their outgoing letters. And so to have both of them, like the reason we have both of them is that he kept copies of the letters he sent, which allows us to have the lovely back and forth and that like six letter series, which I'm hopeful that we'll come across the seventh letter. Responding to, this is the responding to that wildlife center that we saw in the letters from 1959. I am very pleased to know that you can use the Elliott cock. The price of the bird is $15. It is in good condition, except the tail feathers are slightly ragged. I will ship the bird as soon as I receive your requisition. Thank you. Response to AC Gentry, and this one is on onion skin paper, like really thin paper. I don't know that you'll be able to see it, but it's much lighter weight than what we were just looking at. In fact, if I put something else behind it, you can probably see, you can see the writing through this page. That shows you a little bit of how thin this piece of paper is. January 7th, 1960, Dear Mr. Gentry, appreciate very much the check I received today. I am returning to you my check in the amount of $5, for I had just sold a trio of blacknecks. I am shipping you four hens and one cock Sunday night. You should get them Monday afternoon. This is all of my blacknecks for this year. They are easier to raise than ringnecks, for they don't feather pick as badly. These are just starting to grow new tail feathers because I had to keep them with ringnecks and they had pulled all of them. I found that you just can't keep ringnecks and blacknecks together. I have one trio of mutants left that are extra nice and one pair of silvers that are exceptionally good. If I can be of any further service to you, please let me know. So apparently Mr. Gentry was a little bit too slow and didn't get all of the birds that he wanted. So he's getting birds, but also getting a refund of $5 because two of the birds he wanted had already been sold. So here is a letter from Chisholm's Floral and Nursery. Dear sir, please ship Monday, January 18, 1960, five of your Reeves hens of the 57 and 58 hen that have the I don't know that have the broken toe at $4 each. Enclosed find check for $20. So this person is specifically trying to buy five Reeves hens with broken toes that were priced at $4 each. So I'm guessing that has to do with some sort of mutation that gives them a broken-toed appearance. Yes. It does look like they actually typed up a second copy of his correspondence, one to send and one to keep, because they do not appear to be carbons. I don't know what that one is, but seems like sometime in 1960 these moved on to this thin lightweight paper. Dear sir, we really enjoyed the maple syrup on buckwheat cakes yesterday. Thank you very much. Hope you liked the honey. I have 10 stands of bees that I try to take care of, plus the birds. The bees are a lot of work at certain times, but I enjoy doing it. This year I had 210 pounds from 8 of the stands, which is a reasonable average for this area. The other two were or are new swarms. They weren't in too good condition when I bought them, and it took most of last year to build them up. I have a really fancy setup for a hobby beekeeper. I like everything to be about keeping bees. I like everything about keeping bees except bottling the honey, and that is really a job. I live only a few blocks from downtown Salem and 4 miles from the heart of Roanoke. The city limits adjoin, so there isn't too much bloom for the bees. If you have any spare time, you might try them as another hobby. I am half owner of this company, and we do from small to medium commercial work. We just completed a $116,000 sewer line construction in Mount Hope, West Virginia. We have about a 60,000 I think that is supposed to be $60,000 job to start soon in Morgantown, West Virginia. We work all over West Virginia and most of Western Virginia. I have to depend a lot on my wife to take care of my birds, but so far I have been able to work close to home during the egg laying and hatching season. I don't think it is going to work that way this year. I have 12 pens 15 by 10 feet, 3 pens 14 by 15, 3 pens 15 by 17, and 1 pen 17 by 30 feet. All are 7 feet high. I've just finished a 12 by 36 by 12 foot high duck pen. I'm waiting on my federal permit to get a pair of wood ducks. The duck pen has a spring in it, and I buried an old bathtub in the spring to make a duck pond. Therefore, have plenty of clean water and no trouble. Have to get a pair of mandarin ducks soon. Also have 7 4x8 pens with wire floors. You must absolutely raise your chairs on wire until they are nearly fully grown. I have as breeders the following: 1 pair blue Manchurian, 1 trio cheer, 1 pair silvers, 1 trio golden, 2 trio Reeves, 1 pair Urkels, 2 pair Elliots, 1 pair and 1 trio Swino, 1 trio Amherst, 1 pair WG Kalige, and also had blacknecks, ringnecks, mutants, and bobwhite quail, but am not going to raise any more of the last 4. This is too much letter, so long, M.L. Foley. Honestly, that is, I don't know who it was addressed to. It just says, "Dear Sir," but that is the most personal letter we've come across. Everything has been business related, and this one is, it gives some details of like the bird breeding operation that he has, but also talks about his hobby of beekeeping, and it seems like he was involved in sewer construction in West Virginia as well. So some story here, apparently, or more backstory. Like, I feel like I'm watching a tabletop role-playing game or something where somebody's backstory is slowly being revealed. Mr. J.E. Chisholms, Jr., Littlefield, Texas. I appreciate very much the check you sent for $20. All of the birds I am shipping you laid fertile eggs last season. Hope you will be well pleased with them. The birds are in fine plumage, and I have never had any disease of any kind. I am discontinuing raising Reeves because they fight too much. They are very attractive birds and a good seller, but you must have plenty of pens. If you need a new bloodline of Goldens or Mutants, I have a few pair at $5 per pair. I have had a very good season and am practically sold out. Hope you are successful and have a fine season this year. If I can be of any further service, please let me know. The birds will be shipped Sunday night, January 17th at 9 p.m. and should reach you Tuesday evening or Wednesday morning. Ooh, and we have another letter from J.E. Wheeler, which I believe... So we had a letter from him, and then we had a response to him. Which I have... Well, it was a while ago. I'm not going to dig for it too much, too long. Mr. Foley, thank you very much for your letter of January 6th, 1960. I am definitely interested in a pair of Goldens, a pair of Reeves, a pair of Silvers, and only one Mutant. My wife and I plan a trip down to Roanoke and are wondering if you would consider holding these birds for us until Saturday the 23rd. We thought we would drive on down to Salem and look you up so I could see just what you do have and perhaps discuss the various breeds with you. May I hear from you by return mail so that I will know about our trip? If the 23rd is not a suitable date, perhaps I can arrange to be there on Saturday the 16th. Thank you for your prompt reply. Very truly yours, J.E. Wheeler Jr. This is so very much East Coast etiquette. Central East Coast etiquette. Thank you for your letter. Yes, I'm interested. We're going to come and see you. Can you be available on this date? If not, I might be able to come on a different date. And then, thank you for your prompt reply is sort of a passive-aggressive way of saying, respond to me as soon as possible. It's so very Central East Coast. Thank you for your prompt reply is not actually there to thank you. It is there to prompt you to reply. It's an instruction rather than an actual thanks. Let's see. Oh, here's a... Oh my. Oh my, my. My, my, my. Is this... It is... It's letter seven. It's letter seven. From Henry in Lebanon, Connecticut. This time it's typed. January 14th, 1960. Key squared, it's a lot of fun. I received your very nice letter today and I'm glad that you enjoyed the maple syrup. So the letter that we just read that talked about the bees, that just said, dear sir, that we didn't know who it was addressed to, was to the guy in Connecticut whose bantam chicken killed the pheasant chicks. The one, this, so this is letter eight, because this letter about the bees and the maple that starts off with the maple syrup on buckwheat cakes was to this guy in Connecticut. Sorry, I'm really excited because this letter was unidentified. We didn't know who it was to, and now we do. I received your very nice letter today, and I'm glad that you enjoyed the maple syrup. I wanted to get it to you for your for Christmas, but the store where I usually buy it was all out and they had to order more. You know how long it takes to get things around Christmas. I also want to thank you for the honey, which we have been using to glaze sweet potatoes and to baste chickens with when we roast them. At one time, there were a lot of bees kept around this area, but since about the early 40s, most of the small farms which had them have been turned over to raising chickens, and everything that one thinks of as a quaint little farm has just about disappeared from around this area. Although we live out in the country about 7 miles from Willimantic and 35 miles east of Hartford, I own less than an acre of land and have to depend on using my neighbor's land for raising anything. I have just finished cutting enough cedar poles to build a 30 by 125 foot pen this spring, and hope to start some small pens to raise my young ones in this weekend. I have always raised my young ones in small pens, 2 by 4 by 2 with a 1 by 2 foot coop at one end. This worked out very well for me and will take care of a hen and about 12 chicks for 2 to 3 weeks. Moving them every day to new ground is the only problem. I am glad that you told me about the cheer. I'm glad that you told me about the cheers, so we'll have to make other arrangements for them. I did try a small battery brooder once and had leg trouble with my birds, so I have never tried it since. That sure was a very nice deer that you got this fall, and you should be proud of it. I don't do any hunting myself, but do spend a lot of time at the shore, though. I have a small runabout with 35 horse motor on it and spend almost every Saturday and Sunday water skiing, clamming, crabbing, or just riding around on Long Island Sound with it. I'm afraid that I am also guilty of having to have someone take care of my birds. I have to be at work at 7 a.m., so my mother feeds and waters them in the morning, and when I get home, I do what is left to be done. Mother is always giving me hell for having stuff around and having to take care of it, but she really enjoys it as much as I do. An old army buddy of mine came from Roanoke and always wanted me to come home with him, but I never did. I was stationed in the Honor Guard at Washington, D.C. for 2 years and had plenty of opportunity to make a trip down with him, but I'm not fond of really hot weather, and D.C. was enough for me. He had an old motorcycle, which he pushed back and forth on. I think that he said it was 250 miles one way and back, and I don't think I could have taken it. I did make several trips to Luray and up into Cumberland, Maryland. In fact, we took a trip to Luray this fall up through Pennsylvania into New York. It is very nice country down through there, and my mother and aunt really did enjoy it. I wanted to take the entire Skyline Drive into Winston-Salem and back through Norfolk, Virginia, along the coast home. We met some very nice people at Luray Caverns who said the spring is the best time to go south when all the rhododendrons are in blossom, so we decided to make that trip another time. We enjoy traveling very much, so from now until spring, I will have to really get busy and get all my pens made, because when the summer comes, we are off. We are planning on making a trip through Canada and around the Great Lakes this year, if all goes well. So now they're pen pals, apparently, and just talking about their personal lives. This guy, Henry, from Lebanon, Connecticut, apparently was a member of the Honor Guard in Washington, D.C. And if I'm not mistaken, I believe the Honor Guard are the people that guard the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier. Just gonna see what pops up. Honor Guard. I guess they do just lots of ceremonial things. But yeah, they are. Definitely the people who do guard the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier are part of the Honor Guard, but I guess they also do other ceremonial things. So just a very interesting, lots of things mentioned. Luray Caverns, which if you're ever out to the East Coast and you get into the mountainous area of Virginia, Luray Caverns is well worth a visit. especially on a hot day, you go down into the caverns, it's nice and cool. They have a pipe organ that is made of stalactites or built into stalactites. And you can watch people play the stalactite organ. And it's a very touristy caverns area, but it's also a relatively safe one. So even if you're afraid of caves and caverns, it's one that you can stay upright the entire time and walk through. Skyline Drive, he mentions, which is also another big touristy thing in the mountains of Virginia. Just really, really exciting to come across this series of letters here, where we're at 8 letters in on this correspondence between M.L. Foley and this Henry guy from Connecticut. I'm really curious to see if we find any more. But also, I'm looking for more bird letters, too, or more interesting bird things, too. A lot of them are just like this one. Will you please send me your price list? Thank you. Which, honestly, that's a perfectly, perfectly good letter. Perfect form. Oh, yeah, Hannah. If you... let me see if I can get a picture of it. I don't know if I... Oh, my apologies. It is called the stalagmite organ. It's not a stalactite organ. It is the stalagmite organ. I don't want YouTube. I want... Oh, there's a Wikipedia article on it. Oh, that image is too small. Since it's related to the letters that we were showing off, I don't mind showing this picture. There is the stalagmite organ. And I won't spend too much time on it, but I will be happy to read you a short description. The great stalagmite organ is an electrically actuated lithophone located in Luray Caverns, Virginia, USA. It is operated by a custom console that produces the tapping of ancient stalactites of varying sizes with solenoid actuated rubber mallets in order to produce tones. So rather than pipes, it's an organ where they've wired up and put little mallets on the stalactites in the cavern itself. And by playing the organ, it causes the mallets to hit the stalactites and they resonate with sound. And that's how the organ works. So it's definitely worth visiting and seeing that if you're ever out this way. and it is a very touristy area, so it can get crowded. And there are definitely some actual like spelunking caverns in the area where like Skyline Caverns or something like that. You can have more of a traditional like you need gear and you're crawling through crevices type caving experience. But Luray Caverns is one where you walk in, you're upright the whole time, you get some nice views, and you come out the other side. Let's see. We did get resolution on that. The Department of Natural Resources, Division of Wildlife in Ohio, that was inquiring about purchasing the Elliott Cock. So we do have a statement from them. It appears that they did purchase that Elliott Cock. Absolutely. If you come out and visit family in North Carolina, you should all just take a trip up and do Skyline Drive, visit Luray Caverns. That is definitely a thing to do out this way. And if your family in North Carolina hasn't done it, you can drag them up to do it. I find it's often easier, and actually, it's not uncommon for the only time people do touristy things around where they actually live is when people from out of town come to visit. So a lot of the tourist attractions, I've never gone and done on my own. But if people from out of town come and visit, I end up doing them. I don't know that I've ever would have gone and seen Luray Caverns myself if there had not been out of town people to show through it. Dear sir, would you have an extra 1958 or 59 cheer hen? Also pair, what is price? Also Elliot's cocks and price. Sincerely, Cecil Barnett. Very abrupt, some of these things. Like, I get that it's a postcard, but honestly, I would expect more formality in an email today than was on that postcard. Well, Hannah, it is definitely worth it. And visiting family in North Carolina, not only could you come up to like the mountains here and see caves here, or honestly, there are plenty of caves in North Carolina. There's the Eastern Shore in North Carolina, which is a popular touristy area, and DC's not that far. You'd want to stay overnight, and it would probably be like a day's worth of driving. But DC's honestly not that far from North Carolina for like things to do in the area. Trying to make out the first sentence here. Dear sir, your inquiry... Your inquiry... Received, and thank you. I have sold everything except 1959 birds. The cheers were hatched May 8th. The... Swinhauer cocks May 20th and June 5th. I have two cheer cocks and one hen that are exceptionally well grown out for 1959 birds, 1850 for all this. I am still in the beginner class as I have only had birds for something over 2 years, have 13 varieties and would be happy to exchange price lists with you. Hope this will supply your needs. Oh yeah. If you ever want suggestions, just shoot me a note, Hannah. I'm happy to, I'd be happy to give some suggestions for places to see in Virginia and DC for sure. Let's see. I'm going to dig through a little bit, just see if I can find a ninth letter in the series. And then we might look at some pictures of birds from some of the rare books just to close things out. This may be a collection that I need to spend some time with just because I'm finding it really interesting. And so I may want to just, as a personal project, map out some of these letter chains. 'Cause it is, like I said, it's very unusual to have both the incoming and outgoing correspondence. Here we have a letter. It's not letter number 9 in that series. Come to San Francisco. Tis a foggy, chilly place is really selling it. Honestly, foggy and chilly sounds really nice. I think we're supposed to hit around 87 today with 50 to 60% humidity. And sun, no clouds. See, but I heard it in my head, come to San Francisco, it is a foggy, chilly place. I heard in my head, Monty Python and the, like, on second thought, let's not go to Camelot, tis a silly place. It was Monty Python voices in my head saying, come to San Francisco, tis a foggy, chilly place. Anyway, birds and documents. Dear sir, thank you very much for your letter of inquiry on ornamental pheasants. I have only a few pairs of birds left for sale. My sales were beyond my expectations this year, and wish I could have raised double the number. So that's similar to the letter that we had before, but there's a second letter to this person. So I have a response to this basically form letter that M.L. Foley sent. Mr. Foley, I can't read it. I wanted to read it. I thought I could read it. I can't read it, at least not at this distance. Had an awful winter here. In fact, there is still about 1 foot of snow. Oh. That'll be one where I'll have to spend time with it to figure it out if I do end up working with this collection a little bit more. I'm finding the collection very interesting personally, so I might want to take some time and do something with it. But there's then a response from Foley back to Anthony mentioning that they had also had an unusually severe winter. Golden pheasants, mandarin ducks. Oh! So I think there's a permit for the ducks. Camelot may also be there. The fog is so bad you still don't know. But you lack swallows of any continent. Thank you for bringing it back to birds, Portico. Free permit to breed pheasants for market. July 1st, 1960 to June 30, 1961, we have an official permit for the breeding of pheasants. This is from the Commonwealth of Virginia, postmarked July 22nd, 1960, to permittee from Chester F. Phelps, Executive Director, honor before June 30th, 1961. Form for filing report of your activities for this season will be mailed to you. This report must be on file in this office before a permit for the coming season can be issued to you. So basically, here's your permit, and next year you'll have to submit a report on your activities before we'll give you one for next year. But you'll remember he had mentioned he wanted to raise ducks and had built a duck pond. Here we have a letter from Alton Garner to M.L. Foley letting him know about ducks that are available. Dear Mr. Foley, we have 8 or 10 pairs Mandarins 1960 hatch left. They are full winged. Our breeders, 5 pairs, are all in same pen together. When we gather eggs, we place them all together and set them as soon as possible. Therefore, it would be hard to select an unrelated pair. However, there are 4 chances out of 5 to pick a pair that will not be brother and sister. Yeah, food and collections don't mix. So yeah, no coconuts in the archives, presently. Although we don't need coconuts, just coconut shells. Which, strangely, I would not be surprised to find in our archives somewhere. We probably don't know it's there, but I still wouldn't be surprised to find coconut shells. I really want more from this guy in Connecticut, but so far I haven't run across any more. We'll see. I think we've reached the end of 1960. There's a lot more in this collection, and so far this collection has been a lot more fun than I was expecting. Let's see. January 1961. Wait, 1961 is divided by month? Carr, Mears, and Dawson, menswear, clothing, and tailoring, Norfolk, Virginia. Norfolk 10, Virginia. Now, I don't apparently know enough about addresses in the 1960s. I'm guessing that 10 has been overtaken by zip codes today, but that Norfolk 10 was the equivalent of city and zip code. Dear sir, I was looking over the Gazette yesterday at my parents' house? Mr. J.K. Miller and I saw you saw your ad where you may have a hen Soinho, I'm not sure how to say it. I'm not exactly sure how to spell it. I've seen it a couple times, but it was in handwriting and I couldn't make it fully out. I'm not sure what word is actually here, but I just got a pair and the hen got away just pets would appreciate hearing from you and the price. Whew. That handwriting is a little bit different. It could be friend's house, that is true. But, so inquiring about the Soinho, I'm not sure how to say it. Let me see, S-O-U-I-N-H-O-E, Swineho, it's Swinho, S-W-I-N-H-O-E is the type of pheasant. Oh, it's really pretty. Let me pull this up and show you what this type of hen looks like. So this person was looking for a Swinho. Oh, sorry. Well, multiple images here. Let me see if this one will be bigger. Nope. They're small. The pictures are small. Anyway, this lovely, like, cobalt blue and red and white together, just really pretty. So apparently this person had just purchased some, but the hen got away, and so they're inquiring about getting a hen. Just solely on the fact that there looks like there's a dotted eye. Yeah, that makes sense, Hannah. Evidence! He got his duck permit. M.L. Foley. Dear sir, I need 2 Elliot hens, 1 trio of cheer wood ducks. You advertised these in October 61 issue of Gazette. I also want 1 Reeves cock, 2 verse color hens, and 2 mutant black hens. Please quote me prices for immediate delivery on any of these pheasants or ducks. Thanks for your help. And I can't make out the name, but it's Daniel Galbraith in Columbus, Ohio. He got his duck permit and apparently started raising wood ducks. Ooh, ooh. This is exciting. We're right at the end of stream, but I'm happy we finally found one of the international letters. From Jose Raimundo Soho, Abogado Carrera, in Barranquilla, Colombia. January 22nd, 1961. Mr. M.L. Foley, Estados Unidos. Dear Mr. Foley, your kind letters and the book were received in the last days. I am sending you my check for $17. Balance due according to your letter, January 14. Thanks you again. Please find hereby the book about wildfowl, which you sent me. The only kind of wildfowl we have here are Muscovoy duck, page 9, and the 4 kinds signed by a X in the plate 1, page 35. The another are migratory birds, almost all, and for this reason, it is possible that you can get them in the U.S. Some shooters are killing occasionally some of this kind of ducks named in this book. This kinds are not in captivity in this country. If you want, I can to find out about the Muscovoy duck in this country. And the 4 kinds that I have marked on plate 1, page 35. It is no easy to get them. There are no sellers in this business here, but eventually it is possible to get this bird. I would like to service you about this. I would be able to get this kinds of ducks and ship them to you if you will send me the shipping instructions and the import license. The price of this bird's is nothing. The air expenses are very, very expensive. I hope your news. I would be very glad if I can do something for you. The hen of Swinhoe pheasants are laying. That hen have laid 6 eggs. All them have been infertile. Please let me know if this pair have laid fertile eggs for you in the last season. Please advise me what I must do in order to get fertile egg from this pair. What do you think about the reason of the infertility? I am very worried because the Fertz eggs I have from my pheasants are all infertile. I think that's supposed to be first eggs. But, yeah, so this is, apparently he sold some Swinhoe parrots to Mr. Soho in Colombia, and Mr. Soho is also offering to get some Muscovy ducks for Mr. Foley. Yeah, I'm not sure, Hannah, because people are mentioning the Gazette from such a vastly different range of places. So Connecticut, Pennsylvania, the next letter in this folder mentions the Gazette in Kentucky. Oh, nope, this letter gives us the answer, actually, Hannah. Thank you for doing some research. It is the Game Bird Breeders Gazette. And I only know that now when I didn't before, because this letter mentions it by name, by the full name, Game Bird Breeders Gazette. Dear sirs, I notice in the last issue of Game Bird Breeders Gazette that you are advertising Reeves pheasants for sale. We are presently attempting to stock the Reeves pheasant here at Fort Knox in the hope that the bird will reproduce in the wild. As of this date, it appears that this may be a successful venture. In view of our belief at the present time, we have decided to increase our Reeves brood stock for the coming season and am therefore in the market for approximately 50 additional Reeves hens. In the event that you still have any of these birds for sale, I would appreciate hearing from you at your earliest convenience to inform me of the number of birds you have for sale, price, and age of the birds. Max P. Hutton, Master Sergeant Armor, Game Farm Manager, Fort Knox, Kentucky. Key squared, your family raised Muscovy ducks for several years. They worked very hard to earn a series of Darwin Awards. They're not very bright birds. And Hannah, you are pretty good at searching, it seems like. This is the same name of the Gazette that you just found. Just the way they have it worded on the site makes it look like it's two separate things. Yeah, so a little bit of research, reading on through, we came to an answer. But it did take us 2 hours from the first letter mentioning the Gazette to finding one that actually gave us the full name of the Gazette. But honestly, that's not bad. I had actually thought that we would probably go through the letters and, you know, I was prepared. I had the rare books with so that we could look at pictures as we had done before, because the pictures were really interesting and they're well worth looking at, but just in case the letters turned out to be somewhat boring. But I feel like we were very much entertained by reading this guy's mail. The drama of the exchange between him and the purchaser in Connecticut, and that series of 8 letters that we found, that honestly, given the tone of the last 2 letters, I fully hope that there are more letters in there of correspondence between those two people, because they were very, very interesting. So I may just keep this one at my desk for a little bit and spend a little time looking at it some more. And I think we're going to be starting up our blog posts again soon. So I may just need to do a blog post on this collection and particularly that series of letters, that correspondence back and forth between Foley and the guy whose last name I can't remember, but whose first name was Henry, who lived in Connecticut. Anyway, we've reached the end of the stream time for today and the end of June. And since it is the end of June, we will be moving on from the theme of ornithology and oology. And starting next Wednesday on the 8th, is it the 8th next Wednesday? I believe so. Starting next Wednesday, we will be picking up a theme looking at the history of outdoor grilling and barbecuing, particularly looking for information on the history of American backyard grilling. But I do think that the first day will start with materials from like the 19-teens and 20s. and we'll move from there. I'll try to bring materials and we'll look at them somewhat chronologically to see the development of American grilling over time through rare books. And these are gonna be mostly cookbooks. I'll see if I can find any like advertisements for things like Weber grills or anything like that. But yeah, that's what we're gonna be doing at least for the next couple of weeks in July. I'm hopeful it'll take us through the entire month, but if not, I'll come up with something else. But that is the plan. Okay, Philip, thank you. Next Wednesday is the 7th, but we will be live at our regular time to start looking at American grilling. Hannah, it seems like you're good at finding obscure things. Yeah, was not worth it. I may need to look and see if I can find a copy to find a copy of his ad for if I do a blog post. So, all right. So that is gonna be the end of the stream for today. Let me just check and see. It does look like we can do the Monterey Bay Aquarium. It looks like they may have the penguin cam up today, so we will be heading over there from both channels. Thank you everybody who stopped by, hung out with me while we explored this collection of correspondence relating to the sale of birds. I hope to see you next week as we dive into American grilling. And as always, thank you to my mods and everybody for coming by. Thank you, Eric, for the raid earlier. And I will see you all next time. stream ending.